Now, in pages 22 and 23, you'll begin to see how Cherry Valence actually speaks to Derry. From this part, when she says, "You better leave us alone," her tone was very harsh and it was also very hostile. With a tone such harsh tone and hostility, it shows that there is a need to put up a strong front in front of the greasers. It could also mean that she could be feeling intimidated. But we also begin to see how Pony Boy feels towards Cherry Valence. "Gosh, she was pretty. You don't look the type. What's your name? I wish she hadn't asked me that. I hate to tell people my name for the very first time." Now, Pony Boy Curtis, his sense of embarrassment could be stemmed from the fact that he feels inferior to her. Please write this down, that he feels inferior to her, that he feels unworthy of being known to her because he's a greaser. Then I waited for the "you're kidding" or "that's your real name" or one of the remarks I usually get when people know Pony Boy is my real name and I personally like it. The redhead just smiled. "That's an original and lovely name." Now, this shows how our assumptions about people can often be corrected, that we are often too quick to judge ourselves and too quick to assume how people think about us. If you go on to the next page, you'll begin to see that Pony Boy, although Derry always says that he does not use his head in chapter 1, he is actually a very intelligent boy. And this is seen when he says that he got put up a year in grade school. Now, Cherry must be really surprised because he is a greaser, and greasers are often uneducated and unable to afford any form of education. So, for Pony Boy to actually be one grade higher than he is supposed to be reflects that he is not only intelligent, but he's a lot better than the other greasers. That he breaks away from the stereotypical impression that the greasers are just a bunch of trash. Okay? Now, later we see that Cherry talks about Soda saying that his brother is like a doll. This links very much to the fact that Pony Boy actually once called his brother or described his brother to be like a movie star. Soda is handsomer than anyone, not like Derry. Soda's movie star kind of handsome. This is in page 8. So remember, gentlemen, whenever we do, when we study our literature text, we must always, always link it to other parts of the text. So, from all these, we can actually see that the Sulky Girl speaks fondly and admiringly of the greasers. Now, if you would turn with me to pages 30 and 31, we begin to see that Pony Boy is starting to talk about the greasers in its most raw and true self. I really like this quote in page 31. Can you highlight it with me in purple? Okay. "Us greasers usually stick together, but when we do fight among ourselves, it's a fair fight between two. And Deli deserves whatever he gets, cause slash tires ain't no joke when you've got to work and pay for them." Can you highlight this part? "Us greasers usually stick together, but when we do fight among ourselves, it's a fair fight between the two." Now, why would 2-Bit mention anything like this? This is because we begin to see the difference between the way the greasers sort out their issues compared to how Team Shepherd figure out the issues. Either way, there's not going to be any blood feud between our outfit and Shepherd's. Later, we see that Shepherd, Team Shepherd, is actually a very violent gangster. He uses killing, cutting, very violent means to even with his own people in the gang. However, 2-Bit actually mentions this because he is trying to say that among the greasers, although they sort things out, they still protect one another, they still stand by one another, regardless of how difficult the situation is. Okay, gentlemen, please write all these down. If there are extra thoughts that come to you, please take them down as well. Now, going on to pages 32 and 33, you will also start to see that within the society, it is as if Cherry and Pony Boy are not supposed to hang out together because of their class difference. I said nervously because there were plenty of socks milling around and some of them were giving me funny looks as if I shouldn't be with Cherry or something. Not only are people judgmental, it heightens the fact that you cannot hang out with people different from you. And this is a very insensitive and very childish mindset that people have about the society themselves. And that's very, very disappointing. Now, if we go on to pages 35, I also want you to begin to explore the whole concept of identity. Over here, we see the identity of Johnny. They begin to tell us the truth about Johnny, that living in those conditions where they threatened him, everything under the sun, Johnny became high-strung. When you're saying that he's high-strung, it shows the anxiety and fear that he has because of the abusive experiences that he has faced. Now, some of you are able to empathize with this, that sometimes you feel so helpless, you sometimes feel so unsure about yourself because of the abuse that you face at home, the things that people say that makes you question about yourself. Now, living in those conditions might have turned someone else rebellious and bitter. It was killing Johnny. Now, they are saying that it is killing Johnny because Johnny is beginning to lose his sense of self. He is beginning to question who he really is because people constantly abuse him and hurt him. An abusive family that is devoid of love is changing Johnny as a person. And later, what happens to Johnny? If we look later into the chapters, we see that Johnny becomes someone who is as capable of killing another person, of showing violence, because of the very same violence that was inflicted on him. Can you also highlight this part that says that Johnny was jumpier than ever? Highlighted in blue, that reflects identity, because he became even more paranoid and fearful of the possibility of being jumped and attacked. If you're wondering where is the page that reflects the death of Bob and Johnny being the one who murdered Bob, it is actually in page 59. All right, this part, highlighted. Bob the Handsome Sock was lying there in the moonlight, doubled up and still. A dark pool was growing from his head, spreading slowly over the blue-white cement. And then we see that Johnny was the one holding onto the switchblade, proving that he is the one who killed Bob. This also helps us understand that the individual is not who he is today if it was not for the experience that he has been through earlier. This applies for all of us, gentlemen. who I am today and who you are today are made up of a whole bunch of experiences, who you are at home, who you are in school, and who you are when you are all by yourself. All right, now if we go back to our previous pages, page 36. I just want you to pay attention to how Johnny has changed as a character from the very first chapter to the later chapters. And Johnny, who was the most law-abiding among us, now carried in his back pocket as a sage 6-inch switchblade. Now, gentlemen, this is not only a defense mechanism for him, a defense device for him. It is also a symbol that repeats itself throughout the text. Why? Why does S.E. Hinton want us to pay attention to this switchblade? It not only shows how violent and dangerous the neighborhood is, it also shows that the individual has no choice. He has no choice but to stay vigilant and careful by using very violent means to protect themselves. Okay. Oh. Once that is done, I want you to also pay attention to who Deli is. Because Deli is the very person who actually tells Johnny and Pony Boy to hide, to run away, to take the money and protect themselves after killing Bob. Now we see that Deli has actually gone through a lot of difficult situations himself. He had told us about stories of muggings in New York and made the hair on the back of my neck. And then we see again that Dallas was in reform school. Now, the people that goes to reform school are people who have a very serious behavioral issues and they had to be corrected. But we also see that Deli went through experiences with the police, even at the age of 10. So he's actually very familiar with how the system works when he breaks the law. Okay. Now we are going on to chapter 3. Now, chapter 3 is a very beautiful chapter in terms of understanding how the relationship between Cherry and Pony Boy develops over time. Okay. I would like you to also highlight Beatles and thought Elvis Presley was out. Now, the Beatles and Elvis Presley were very famous icons back in the 1960s in terms of music. And they are very much associated to the Greasers because, like we have seen in chapter 2 earlier, where they go to the Dingoes and the Jays in page 20, this further reflects the blues and the jazz that they often listen to as individuals. Okay. Now we begin to see why the Greasers have so much admiration for the Socky Girls, because Greasy Girls would have acted a lot tougher. Please highlight it in purple. But there was a basic sameness. Sameness between the Socks and the Greasers. That in spite of the class differences, there is something that they can relate with each other. There is something that they can relate with each other. I thought it was the money that separated us, but it seems that Pony Boy begins to realize that it is more than the money. It seems that there are also expectations that the Greasers and the Socks are trying to put up. You Greasers have different sets of values. Highlight this. Okay? You're more emotional. We are sophisticated. Look at the language used by Cherry. He is describing the Greasers to be more emotional, but they're more sophisticated. Cool to the point of not feeling anything. Nothing is for real with us. Can you highlight this part? Now we realize that the class difference are stemmed not only from the lifestyle, but the expectations that they have to fulfill. And what do I mean? If you cross-reference to the later pages, cross-reference it to page 40. You will begin to see that she is very different herself and when she's with her girlfriend. Okay, so linked to the theme of appearance versus reality, the sock is trying to keep up a reputation to feel a sense of belonging. Okay, highlight this part. I don't really think a beer blast or the river bottom is super cool, but I'll rave about it to a girlfriend just to say something. Just to say something. So she's trying to do all these things just to keep up a reputation, just to identify herself as a sock. And now remember, it is so important to keep up with an identity for the sock and the greasers so that you have a sense of alliance. You have a sense of belonging. You have a whole bunch of people to back you up in such a dangerous and unexpected, unpredictable environment. Okay. And then we also begin to see that Pony Boy says that I've never told that anyone that I think you're the first person I've ever really gotten to. Sorry, this is it by Cherry. I think you're the first person I've really gotten to. This is the development of a friendship between the sock and the greaser, a seemingly impossible thing within society. Before I go on deeper onto what these mean, remember about appearance versus reality. Later in the chapter, we see that Sock, like Cherry, actually do not want to be acknowledged by someone like Pony Boy. She actually tells Pony Boy to not acknowledge her when they see each other at the school hall, so that she can continue to remain in the community that she wants to be identified with. Okay? Now, I also like this part. Can you highlight this? Rat race is a perfect name for it. Now, what is a rat race? A rat race is like a competition. You are like pursuing something aimlessly when there is no real objective and you just want to prove yourself to be better than others. And the interesting thing is actually the fact that the sock and the greasers could realize that maybe, just maybe, if we lose our cool, we could. That if they lose our cool, they'll begin to actually reconcile. That if they put their pride aside, they can begin to be friends. They can actually begin to resolve the issues between them. I would also like you to highlight this part. It seems like we're always searching for something to satisfy us and never finding it. So it seems that the sock and the greasers are constantly fighting with each other just to build a name for themselves, just to be superior to the other. It is a power struggle, okay, boys? It is a power struggle. And because of this power struggle, the need to be in the rat race, the need to feel powerful compared to the other, is the very reason why we are separated. It's not money, it's feeling. You don't feel anything and we feel too violently. The socks don't feel anything, yet the greasers feel violently. It is this constant pursuit that lead them to be divided and thus leading the society to be divided as well. Okay. Now we also want to see that nobody but Soda could get Pony Boy talking till he met Cherry Valence. This shows how close he feels towards her, how affectionate he feels for her, okay? And yes, Soda's horse, Mickey Mouse. Remember, Mickey Mouse is Soda's horse. Now, I also want you to begin to look into page 42, where they talk about the sunset. Now, the sunset is a very symbolic icon. It represents a sense of beginning and ending. It's also very sentimental because it is Cherry Valance and Pony Boy that shares the sunset later in the chapter 4 and 5, okay? And then we see how Cherry bit her nail, and then she talks about even she feels very uncomfortable in the presence of Socky Boys, the Sock Boys, okay? Randy and Bob. Maybe they won't see us act normal. Who's acting? I'm a natural normal. Wish it was the other way around, Ponyboy muttered. And then Two-Bit said, don't get mouthy, Ponyboy. It shows that the presence of the Sock Boys often induces a sense of intimidation and threat. Okay, now, I would like you to look into the Brotherhood. Now that we are in page 44, I would like you to see this part. He thinks I'm a pain in the neck. He likes a soda. Everybody likes soda, but he can't stand me. He is dairy, not deli, dairy. Now, this is a reflection of Brotherhood because we are beginning to see that Pony Boy has developed some sense of jealousy. He is starting to feel that he is a pain in the neck. That means he is awfully burdensome. Pony Boy is awfully burdensome. And where do we see this very same thing that he repeats? If you go back to the end of chapter 1. If you go back to chapter 1, page 19. I was just another mouth to feed and somebody to holler at. Can you highlight this? Hey, gentlemen, sorry, I'm not using the ruler because I'm also doing the video, so I hope you understand. Now, if you look at this part, we recognize again that Pony Boy already questions his love, Derry's love for him, and that Pony Boy sees himself as a burden, as something that Derry has to just take care of because he is an older brother. Now, how many of you actually feel this way, that you're just another person that your brother has to take care of, that your brother just has to take care of you because he's an older brother? Now, this is what Pony Boy thinks Derry is doing for him, but it's not true. Derry genuinely loves Pony Boy, and that is why he is so firm with him. And also, we see how Pony Boy feels about Soda Pop, okay? Page 19. Soda was wrong for once, I thought. Derry loved anyone or anything except maybe Soda. So we see the same sense of jealousy. And if we go back to page 44. This very sentence actually emphasizes, okay? It emphasizes Pony Boy's jealousy, Pony Boy's want for Derry's affection. As a younger brother, okay? Now, I would like you to also look into page 45 where we see that the brothers are actually doing a lot for Pony Boy. A lot of sacrifices were made for Pony Boy just to put him through school. Soda Pop, a dropout, so he could get a job and keep me in school. And Derry getting old before his time, trying to run a family and hang on to two jobs and never having any fun. While the Socks had so much spare time and money that they jumped on us and each other for kicks. This actually shows that Pony Boy has a lot of empathy. He is able to understand the world around him. And he's beginning to question why is everything so unfair. But the fact that Pony Boy is entitled to his brother's love and affection reflects that he is not alone, that he is actually very much protected and loved by them. And then we see that the Sock finally appears and would actually like to show off in a sense that he says, baby, you know we don't get drunk very often. When she only gave him a cold stare, he got angry. It shows that the Socks, it actually really proves this, that the Socks has so much time and money to spare that they just do things for kicks. Just to prove themselves. Now, if you go on to page 48, let's take a 5-second rest. Once you're ready, let's go on to page 48. Now, in page 48, we would like to see how Ponyboy's character is actually very meek. He's very soft-hearted. He is not violent. He couldn't cut anyone. Even later in the chapters, he never cuts anyone. He is too afraid. He's too vulnerable. Okay? And then we also see that Johnny and Ponyboy begin to make some realizations about life. It was because we're greasers, Johnny said. And I knew he was talking about Cherry. We could have hurt her reputation. Now, if they were actually socks, it doesn't matter that Cherry hangs out with them. The class differences actually is revealed through Johnny's tone of defeat, because he feels helpless and powerless in changing his fate, that he actually cares about Cherry, but there's nothing much that he can do just because they are a greaser. Sometimes in life, we do not have much of a choice, do we? That we are probably second class, probably first class, probably third class. But sometimes it seems that people fail to realize that people, some of us just really do not have a choice. Yet they put us into different strata of class, of who we are, of who we should be. And this is further emphasized later in page 50. We were as good as they were. It wasn't our fault we were greasers. We really do not decide the life that we have. Yet, circumstances often define us. Circumstances often put us in where we should be. I felt the tension growing inside of me and I knew something had to happen or I would explode. Okay. This is actually by far one of my favorite phrases inside the book. It seems like there's got to be some place without greasers or socks, with just people. Plain, ordinary people. Now, the irony is that we are people ourselves, but we are not plain and irony. We would like to ordinary. We often like to associate ourselves with something, to feel a sense of belonging. What Ponyboy is trying to say here is that he wants to break away from judgment. He wants people to see them for who they are and see them as an equal, to accept them, to love them, to break away from the stereotypes just because they're greasers. Now, this is a dream, the ideal that Ponyboy would like to have. He would love to have to be at a country where he can just rest his back under a tree, draw, read, do not worry about being jumped, married to someone that is not brainless, someone that is not impulsive, someone that is not violent or abusive. And more importantly, the most touching part that I felt was that he actually wants to be complete, where his mom and dad would be there. That his mom and dad would be there to take care of them, to lead a normal family life that everybody has taken for granted. Okay. Now that is done. I would like to see all of you flip to page 53 because, wow, we see that Jerry's care and concern is actually so firm and strict that he eventually slaps Ponyboy. Soda then becomes the mediator, as always, to resolve the relationship and tension between them. Now that we have covered chapters 2 and 3, chapter 4 is actually where we begin to see Johnny's violent nature. Before we go into that, I would like you to turn to page 57 where we begin to see Ponyboy's helplessness. I wish for that broken bottle, that very broken bottle that he always sees, that is being used as a defense mechanism, that he would like to use it to defend himself now. Yet, we see in page 59, the death of Bob and the very violent nature that we have covered earlier that Johnny takes on. Okay. And because it is the very first time they attacked anyone, who became the first person that they run to? It is no other than the one character, the most gangster character in the group, Deli. Okay. We got to see Deli. All right, gentlemen, I think we have covered quite a bit, but I would also like you to look at how the relationships between Daddy and Johnny has changed, and also the appearance of Shepherd. Okay? Now, I would like all of you to start reading The Outsiders for the remaining part of the lesson. We have covered chapters 2, 3, and briefly chapter 4. Later, you will be doing a book review challenge, so I suggest that you start reading the parts that you're unfamiliar with. So, all the best, gentlemen, and if there are any questions, please feel free to send me an email. All right.